The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
Without freedom of the press, no democratic form of government could exist.
We switch you now to London.
I'm standing on a rooftop looking out over London.
Good night and good luck.
Good evening from our CBS newsroom in New York.
NBC presents Chet Huntley and David Brinkley.
From ABC, this is World News Tonight. With Peter Jennings in London, Max Robinson in Chicago, and from our desk in Washington, Frank Reynolds.
Good evening.
This historic legislation, the telecommunications law, will create many, many high-wage jobs, will create opportunity and better lives for all Americans.
When the press is free, the people of a country are free. When the press is not free, the people of a country are in danger of slavery.
Keeping you informed with information, news, and the views of people making the news. It's the Nicole Sandler Show on NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
Out in the West Texas town of El Paso, I saw a speech by a man Putin adores. He talked about walls, fake news, and then more walls, and how you can't own cows anymore.
You're not allowed to own cows anymore.
After an intro by the Zodiac Killer, fear Trump did monger in his monologue.
It's the radical left coming for your money, and they're coming for your freedom.
Caravan socialists and socialist caravans then rambled on and on about dogs.
You do love your dogs, don't you? I wouldn't mind having one, honestly, but I don't have any time.
Although his pants are clearly on fire, it turns out he said one thing that was true.
I'm guilty!
That was the cold open from Stephen Colbert's late show last night. You know, I almost opened yesterday's song with Marty Robbins' El Paso, but I thought it was too obvious. And there Stephen Colbert goes and makes it better. So, yes, thank goodness for Colbert and humor. Welcome to Wednesday. I'm Nicole Sandler at NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network and a plethora of other stations that carry the show. We thank them for doing so. Today happens to be World Radio Day, believe it or not. And the funny thing is, let me read to you. World Radio Day, I guess, was enshrined, so to speak, 8 years ago. This is the eighth edition of World Radio Day, as so declared by UNESCO. And here's their explanation of what World Radio Day is. Quote, "This day marks a time where people around the world celebrate radio and how it shapes our lives. Radio informs, transforms, and unites us. It brings together people and communities from all backgrounds to foster positive dialogue for change. More specifically, radio is the perfect medium to counter the appeals for violence and the spread of conflict, especially in regions potentially more exposed to such realities. On that basis, World Radio Day 2019 will celebrate the theme of dialogue, tolerance, and peace." Oh, shit, I don't have my laugh track handy. But if I did, it would be laughing loudly and clearly. Because radio in the United States is none of those things. It used to be. Even when I used to produce, one of my first professional radio jobs out of college was in New York at WMCA, and I produced the Bob Grant program. And Bob Grant was the original, or one of the original, right-wing nut jobs on talk radio. But that was in the days before there was, you know, right-wing talk radio and progressive talk radio, not that that exists anymore, and, you know, and the highly formatted, segregated formats that we now hear, mostly on AM radio stations. Bob Grant used to open his show talking about this is an exchange of ideas and opinions. That's the opposite of what happens today. And I bring this up because we our guest today is Norman Goldman. I kind of ask him if he really, you know, pronounces his name that way, because he can't. Sorry. Anyway, Norman Goldman, a radio guy, but not for too much longer, because he announced on his program last week that it's costing him too much money, and he's going to hang it up. Now, if you've been listening to this program for any amount of time, you know the struggle that people in our position face. This used to be a thriving industry, and it still is. Radio still makes money. They're just not employing as many people, and the ones they employ, they're not paying as well. These days, the rarity is finding a radio job. Whoops. Speaking of radio, this is my ringtone. Speaking about radio. All right, hold on. Let's turn that off. Let's mute the phone. Sorry, I should have done that before the program. Funny that my husband, just moments before I came on the air, showed me a letter to the editor that's in today's Miami Herald. Let me share it with you because it relates. The headline reads, "Local talk radio is too biased and amateurish." Go figure. And the letter goes like this. "To those like me who miss the days of real good talk radio shows in our city, here are some thoughts on the subject. We have one AM general news and talk station in South Florida, and that is WIOD. It carries ultra-right-wing commentary with luminaries such as Rush Limbaugh, Sean Hannity, Glenn Beck, etc. Until just over a year or so ago, it kept vestiges of contrasting commentary by having local host Fernand Amande comment for the progressive side in the mornings. Although he was excellent, his show was terminated without explanation." That's how they do it. "So that the station could only cater to the ultra-right conspiracy theory conservative factions. There is no other radio station in this town that caters to progressive agendas, even though this is a county which usually votes Democrat." Ick. Let me add the ick. This, to me, is quite disturbing and scary, as there is no contrasting competition to the vitriol spewed out of that station. On the sports radio side, there are two stations basically owned by the same company without any competition. Actually, there are four, but I digress. With very few exceptions, these stations have decided not to have established hosts as there used to be years ago. They have gone with 18-year-olds, fresh out of high school, impersonating sports show hosts. Also, there are very few local shows left in sports radio programming. It is mostly all syndicated garbage broadcast from other cities by networks such as CBS or ESPN, discussing what is happening in places like Seattle and Wyoming. Other than the fairly informative and neutral programming by the public radio stations on FM, there is nothing else to listen to in Miami. This is pretty sad for a city which is supposed to be world class." And signed, Herman Isery in West Kendall. That's down in Miami. And see, therein lies the problem. I did a talk on Saturday at the Deerfield Beach Progressive Forum. And I got to say, first of all, thank you to those people for inviting me. And secondly, thank you to them for having this great progressive forum where they invite speakers from all stripes, in the season. I think they run from December through March because it's Florida, you know. But it was about the state of media today, and it's really sad. The fact is that the public airwaves are not public anymore. Although the airwaves are owned by the people, they are. Stations are licensed to broadcast on those frequencies. It's to quote Ilhan Omar, it's all about the Benjamins, baby. And that has nothing to do with, being Jewish. It's all about the money and the big companies that now control the radio and other media in cities all around the country. As I was telling people on Saturday, when I first got into radio in the olden days, my first radio job was 40 years ago, 1979. The rules, the ownership rules, were pretty strict. It was a company could own one AM, one FM, and one TV station in a market. And they could own a maximum, I believe, of seven of each. It might have been fewer newspapers, but seven AM, seven FM stations spread out through the country. Now, thanks to the Telecommunications Act of 1996 and Bill Clinton, who signed it into law, one company can own eight radio stations in a single market. Where each of those eight radio stations used to employ its own program director and staff, promotions director, sales staff, on-air lineup. Now, most of the jobs are shared. In some cases, it's one program director for the entire cluster, whether it's two stations or seven. And as far as the air talent, if you're lucky, you might have a live morning show at your local station. But the rest of the day is probably voice tracked, meaning somebody is sitting in a studio somewhere in a city far away. And, you know, if it's a music station, they're just doing the intros and outros, you know, it take them about 20 minutes to do a 4-hour show. And then they upload it and they walk away and it airs in, you know, City X the following day. This is what radio is now. And in terms of talk radio, what used to be the great town hall meeting, right? Local talk radio was the lifeline of a community. That doesn't exist anymore. They're all mostly all syndicated programs. Again, if you're lucky, your town has a local morning show. But after that, the rest of the day is all syndicated stuff. One of the things I always loved about radio was the immediacy and the intimacy and the local nature of it. Radio is supposed to be a local medium, and it isn't anymore. Anyway, there's my little diatribe to get us started on World Radio Day. And Norman Goldman will join us at the bottom of the hour to talk about, you know, his story and I guess what's going to happen next for him. Speaking of Ilham Omar, I came out in support of her yesterday. I still don't think what she said was anti-Semitic. I think sometimes we can all be too sensitive, whether it's, you know, because money is mentioned and it's taken as an anti-Semitic thing, or, you know, depending on what demographic group you fall into, there are things that are going to trigger something in you that others might not hear it as an issue, but you do. I think we're all a bit too sensitive at this point. But I got to play something, and we have time. Ilhan Omar, I don't know what committee this was on, but yesterday, I think it was the Foreign Affairs Committee, which, you know, Trump and the Republicans are trying to get her kicked off of. Well, they had Elliot Abrams on yesterday. Did I? I closed that window. Hold on. I have the her questioning of Elliot Abrams, and I want to hold on. I want to get the background so I can put it into context for you. So the hearing was, let's see. All right, from the Hill. This is how they set it up. It says Representative Ilhan Omar of Minnesota engaged in a testy back and forth on Wednesday with Special Envoy to Venezuela Elliot Abrams, accusing the diplomat of being a liar and pressing him on his involvement in the Iran-Contra scandal and killings in Central America during the Reagan administration. You know what? Abrams is an old guy. I'm amazed he's coming back. Anyway, I was so impressed with her questioning of him that I thought I should share it with you. Here we go.
In 1991, you pleaded guilty to 2 counts of withholding information from Congress regarding your involvement in the Iran-Contra affair, for which you were later pardoned by President George H.W. Bush. I fail to understand why members of this committee or the American people should find any testimony that you give today to be truthful.
If I can respond to that.
It wasn't a question.
It wasn't a question.
On February 8th,
who is not permitted to reply.
That was not a question. Thank you for your participation. On February 8th, 1982, mm-hmm. you testified before the Senate Foreign Relations Committee about U.S. policy in El Salvador. In that hearing, you dismissed as communist propaganda report about the massacre of El Masote, in which more than 800 civilians, including children as young as 2 years old, were brutally murdered by U.S.-trained troops. During that massacre, some of those troops bragged about raping a 12-year-old girl before they killed them. Girls before they killed them. You later said that the U.S. policy in El Salvador was a fabulous achievement. Yes or no, do you still think so?
From the day that President Duarte was elected in a free election to this day, El Salvador has been a democracy. That's a fabulous achievement.
Yes or no, do you think that massacre was a fabulous achievement that happened under our watch?
That is a ridiculous question, and I
yes or no.
No.
Yes or no.
I will take that as a yes.
I am not going to respond to that kind of personal attack.
Yes, you are.
Which is not a question.
Yes, it is.
Yes or no, would you support an armed faction within Venezuela that engages in war crimes, crimes against humanity or genocide, if you believe they were serving U.S. interest, as you did in Guatemala, El Salvador, and Nicaragua?
I am not going to respond to that question. I'm sorry. I don't think this entire line of questioning is meant to be real questions, so I will not reply.
Whether you, under your watch, a genocide will take place, and you will look the other way because American interests were being upheld, is a fair question. Because the American people want to know that anytime we engage a country, that we think about what our actions could be and how we believe our values are being furthered. That is my question. Will you make sure that human rights are not violated and that we uphold international and human rights?
I suppose there is a question in there, and the answer is that the entire thrust of American policy in Venezuela is to support the Venezuelan people's effort to restore democracy to their country. That's our policy.
I don't think anybody disputes that. The question I had for you is that does the interest of the United States include protecting human rights and include protecting people against genocide?
That is always the position of the United States.
Bullshit.
Thank you. I yield back my time.
Good for her. So Ilhan Omar, the freshman Muslim representative from Minnesota, questioning Elliot Abrams, who for whatever god-awful reason is the new U.S. envoy to Venezuela. That can't end well. Just saying thank you to Congresswoman Omar for that questioning. All right, there's news before we get to Norman Goldman. I guess let's do the news. Oh, I was going to do it live, and I didn't pull the... I'm having one of those days, just sort of a discombobulated day. So let me get the open here, and we'll do it live.
I read the news today.
Oh, boy.
It's time for Nicole Sandler's What's News from NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
Well, the budget deal brokered by a bipartisan group of lawmakers appears to be headed to the president's desk, and Trump has signaled that he'll sign it despite his earlier protestations.
I can't say I'm happy. I can't say I'm thrilled.
Too bad.
But the wall's getting built. Regardless, doesn't matter, because we're doing other things beyond what we're talking about here.
Yeah.
So we'll see what happens.
Yeah, we'll see what happens. The compromise includes $1.375 billion for 55 miles of new fences along the border, well short of the $5.7 billion Trump had sought for 234 miles of steel walls. At the rally in El Paso on Monday night, signs around the arena read, "Finish the wall," as Trump lied to the crowd, claiming construction was already underway.
Today, we started a big, beautiful wall.
No, you didn't.
On the Rio.
No, you didn't. No, you didn't. Liar.
Right smack on the Rio Grande.
No, you're lying. You know what? So that calls for some fact checking. So we'll listen to, once again, Shepard Smith, who actually tells the truth on Fox.
A bipartisan deal on border security. The Senate Majority Leader, the Republican Mitch McConnell, calls it good news. His Democratic counterpart, Chuck Schumer, calls it a path forward. Some more conservative Republicans are crying foul. But President Trump, are you happy?
Am I happy at first glance? I just got to see it. The answer is no. Yeah. I'm not. I'm not happy. But am I happy with where we're going? I'm thrilled. Because we're supplementing things and moving things around and we're doing things that are fantastic and taking from far less, really from far less important areas.
Yeah, and, like California and Puerto Rico.
That's incorrect. He's been saying it for a while now, but it's simply not true. The facts are these. Workers have replaced and repaired sections of the existing wall and fences, but so far they have not built anything new. Construction is set to begin on a 14-mile extension in the Rio Grande Valley later this month. And this just-announced deal in Congress could create 55 miles of new fencing and barrier. No wall. That's if it passes in Congress and if the president signs it. And even then, it's 10 miles less than what lawmakers offered the White House last year, long before the government shutdown.
Yep.
Still, there is some wiggle room that could allow the president to add more money for his proposed wall and more money for detaining people. Presuming, of course, this deal gets done.
We'll see. A White House official told the Washington Post that Trump sees signing the border deal, if passed by Congress, as the way to avoid another shutdown. But he would also likely pursue an executive order to reallocate federal funds to barrier projects. That, of course, would be met with lawsuits because only Congress can appropriate money. Stay tuned. Now, the budget deal must pass by Friday at midnight in order to avoid another shutdown. And Congress is scheduled to be out next week. Of course they are, for President's Day. Now, here's one of the sticking points. The Violence Against Women Act was extended as part of the last government funding bill, and it expires on Friday. Republicans have pushed for a straight, clean extension as part of this bill, but Democrats want to deal with the VAWA separately. They have their own bill, but if it's not extended before Friday, it will expire. CNN last night proved it learned absolutely nothing from its coverage of the 2016 presidential elections and for some reason held a town hall event in Houston with former Starbucks CEO Howard Schultz, who hasn't even announced his candidacy yet, but has said he'd run as a centrist independent. Schultz criticized progressive tax increases, called the Green New Deal plan immoral without offering specifics on how he would address those issues differently. He also refused to commit to selling his Starbucks shares if he were to be elected president. And when pressed, Schultz wouldn't say he'd drop out of the race if polls showed his candidacy was helping Trump. He was panned, like, oh my God, taken to task on the Twitters, especially for his comments regarding Starbucks' handling of that racial profiling incident in Philadelphia last month.
Starbucks is a diverse organization, and we want to do everything we can. It was a terrible moment for the company. It's not something that we're going to forget, and it's something that we learned a great deal from, and we're still learning it about. And I would just say, as somebody who grew up in a very diverse background as a young boy in the projects, I didn't see color as a young boy. And I honestly don't see color now. And I want to do everything I can in terms of the character and the dignity of what it means to be the president of the United States.
Oh, my God. The internet quickly pointed out that "I don't see color" was a running Stephen Colbert gag.
I want to say that I am not a racist. I don't even see race. Not even my own. People tell me I'm white, and I believe them because I just devoted 6 minutes to explaining how I'm not a racist.
There you go. Tomorrow is a, a dreaded day, around, especially around these parts. Tomorrow marks the first anniversary of the mass shooting at Marjorie Stoneman Douglas High School in Parkland, 5 minutes down the road, that left 17 people dead. On Tuesday, my congressman, Ted Deutch, who represents the district, and Senator Bob Menendez of New Jersey introduced a bill banning any gun magazine that exceeds 10 rounds of ammunition. During a news conference on Capitol Hill, the Democrats described the bill as one step in a process of passing individual gun control measures instead of a big comprehensive package. One of those, in the House Judiciary Committee today, they'll mark up the Bipartisan Background Checks Act of 2019, which requires background checks on all firearm sales. It's the next stop, I guess, on the road to getting a vote on the legislation. At least there's some motion there. Here's a little bit of good news for a change. The Senate yesterday overwhelmingly passed the most sweeping conservation legislation in a decade, protecting millions of acres of land and hundreds of miles of wild rivers across the country, and establishing four new national monuments honoring heroes of including Civil War soldiers and a civil rights icon. The vote was a remarkable 92-8. I know, you're wondering, so who were the eight assholes who voted no? That's what I'm here to tell you. First of all, of course, they were all Republicans. Ted Cruz of Texas, Jim Inhofe of Oklahoma, Ron Johnson of Wisconsin, James Lankford of Oklahoma, Mike Lee of Utah, Rand Paul of Kentucky, Ben Sasse of Nebraska, and Pat Toomey of Pennsylvania. That's right. Just keep them all in mind. The national debt has passed a new milestone, topping $22 trillion for the first time. The Treasury Department's daily statement showed yesterday that the total outstanding public debt stands at actually $22.01 trillion. It was $19.95 trillion when Donald Trump took office on January 20th, 2017. And finally, if you're thinking Trump hasn't been golfing much lately, take a look again at all the executive time on his leaked schedules. The Washington Post this morning reporting that Trump has installed a room-sized golf simulator game at the White House in one of the spare rooms in the residence. It allows him to play virtual rounds of golf at courses all over the world by hitting a ball into a large video screen. There's your executive time for you. Yeah, in case you were wondering. There was one, I was watching MSNBC last night. I do enjoy Chris Hayes most of the time. Although lately I got to question some of the guests they have on. But, you know, hey, that's just me. But, you know, he does this thing, one thing, too. And he pointed out something about Donald Trump's insecurities, which we all knew. But this brought us back to, the opening days of his administration when this happened.
This was the largest audience to ever witness an inauguration, period, both in person and around the globe.
The field was, it looked like a million and a half people.
Yeah, so Donald Trump, we learned, likes to exaggerate size, right? And he did it the other night, Monday night. He was in El Paso, Texas, and he lied about the crowd size. The official estimates were that the capacity of the arena that Trump held his rally in was 6,500. Despite what you'll hear Trump lying about in a moment, the fire marshal did not let in one person over that 6,500 mark. He said they were capped at the capacity at 6,500. There was an overflow crowd, somewhere between 6,000 and 10,000 people. Okay, so keep that in mind when you hear this.
Tonight, 69,000 people signed up to be here. Now, the arena holds 8,000.
No, 6,500.
Thank you, fire department. They got in about 10.
No, they didn't. No, they didn't. He's a fucking liar. Oh, and there's more.
He challenged us. So we have, let's say, 35,000 people.
Talking about Beto.
And he has 200 people,
no.
300 people, not too good.
Okay, Trump didn't have 35,000. He had more like 6,500. We'll be generous and say 10 to 15,000. And it was estimated that Beto O'Rourke pulled in 10 to 15,000 people. Go figure, right? But you know what it all goes back to, don't you?
Look at those hands. Are they small hands? He referred to my hands. If they're small, something else must be small. I guarantee you there's no problem. I guarantee.
Ew. One other thing. I'd be remiss if I didn't comment on this. At that rally, one of the members of the crowd, one of the frenzied attendees, finally attacked one of the journalists in the press area. Somebody went after the cameraman for the BBC. And Sarah Huckabee Sanders came out, I think it was this morning, and spoke to the press and said that Donald Trump never incited violence. This is what he said. What
you
said.
Have put out a statement that is over the line. People, you condemn any sort of attacks on anybody, right?
Absolutely. And the idea that the president or anybody on his team or in his administration would encourage violence is absolutely absurd. The president stopped, asked and made sure everyone was okay before continuing on with the event. Certainly we condemn violence in any form against anyone, and that certainly includes the press.
Yeah, you know what that is, don't you?
Bullshit.
In case you needed proof, and I know you don't, just a little waltz down memory lane.
If you see somebody getting ready to throw a tomato, knock the crap out of them, would you? Seriously. Okay? Just knock the hell. I promise you, I will pay for the legal fees, I promise. The guards are very gentle with him. He's walking out like big high fives, smiling, laughing, like to punch him in the face, I'll tell you. All right, yeah, get him out. Try not to hurt him. If you do, I'll defend you in court. Don't worry about it.
Oh, my God.
Hillary wants to essentially abolish the Second Amendment. By the way, and if she gets to pick... If she gets to pick her judges, nothing you can do, folks. Although the Second Amendment people, maybe there is. I don't know.
The Second Amendment people, maybe there is. That's the man that Sarah Sanders dares to say has never incited violence? Once again,
bullshit.
Unbelievable. All right. I told you today is World Radio Day. it's just a coincidence. I had invited Norman Goldman on the show before I realized that today was World Radio Day. But, you know, what better time to have him on? I made a little intro montage to welcome him. It's probably going to get us, you know, copyright violated on YouTube. And I know our pal Paul Leary is experimenting with Facebook Live and Periscope and stuff today. Hopefully we're not booted off of everywhere. But here's my little salute to radio.
Hey. Can't find nothing on the radio. Don't you know you can't get near me? Can't only hold you. Hear me on the radio. The radio, yeah. You gotta hear me on the radio. So you had better do as you were told.
Portions of the day's programming are reproduced by means of electrical transcriptions or tape recording.
Oh, honey, you turn me on. I'm the radio.
FM AM, where are you? You gotta be out there somewhere on the dial. On the dial.
Turn on your radio, baby. Listen to my song. Turn on your nightlight, baby, baby.
So many better songs about radio than radio is these days. But what a history it has. And with that, I'm really thrilled to welcome our guest today onto the show. Norman Goldman has been broadcasting on his own program, The Norman Goldman Show, for, I don't know how long. What I do know is that Norm made an announcement to his audience, I believe last week, that his show is coming to a close. So I wanted to invite him on and talk about why, the state of things in radio and the state of the media, I suppose, as it is. Norman Goldman, are you there?
I am here. Hi, Nicole.
Hey, Norm. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Well, thanks for inviting me. It's very kind.
It is my pleasure and my honor to have you here. Now, I got to ask about the name. Do you actually go by Norman Goldman, or is it Norm?
I do.
You do?
I do.
People call you Norman?
Well, my wife calls me Norm. My friends call me Norm.
Yeah.
So it's easy to go by, you know, like from Cheers.
Yep.
Norm.
Norm.
It's easy.
Hey, Norm.
I stumbled upon the Norman Goldman thing because I'm the only person on the planet who can't pronounce their own name like a normal human being. I discovered when I was like 19, I was on the phone a lot. I was working as an intern in a congressman's office in New York City, and I was on the phone a lot doing constituent service. and people would say, I'd say my name, Norman Goldman, and they'd say, Warren Moldman? And I never got them to say my name back. And I'd say, no, not Warren. Warren Moldman is not even a name. How could you think I'd be that name? Anyway, so I finally just started out of frustration. This is a true story. I said, Norman Goldman. And they started laughing.
Uh-huh.
And Nicole, it didn't take long for me to realize I had stumbled upon shtick. But the reason I had stumbled upon shtick, and of course I'm a New Yorker, so we know shtick,
mm-hmm.
but it's just I couldn't pronounce my name. It was frustration. I couldn't get my name across. How's that for pathetic?
Well, that
and
works.
So I came upon Norman Goldman.
Gotcha.
And it just stuck.
And it
and
did
so
stick.
So I got used to it, and it worked.
Now, it was years ago. It's got to be trying to, you know, put the time into perspective, and everything's warped. But it's definitely more than a decade ago that I remember hearing you on the Ed Schultz show and then filling in for Ed. Is that how you got started in radio, or were you in radio before?
Well, actually, I met Ed in July of 2004 at the Democratic National Convention.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when I met Ed, and I was first on his show. It was about 6 months into the launch of his show is when I met him at the DNC. That was the one where that young fellow named Obama made that
sure.
famous speech about the red America and the blue America.
I remember that, yeah.
Well, I was sitting not too far behind him over his left shoulder and with a press pass because I was doing radio that summer locally in Los Angeles. I bought my way on brokered time
wow.
to KLSX, Howard Stern Station.
Oh, my God.
In LA.
I used to work there. Go figure.
I know you did. You're a legend in Los Angeles yeah. local radio. Yeah. I mean, geez.
Yeah.
You've been on a bunch of stations. We know you.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
We love you.
I used to
listen to you all the time.
Did
Mark
you?
And Brian. I mean, geez.
Yeah. Wow. Goes way back.
Back in the day.
Yep. So I was at KLSX. They were classic rock before Howard Stern.
So I brokered some time,
mm-hmm.
and then they offered me a press pass because of the convention. I went, and a guy, we both, I suspect, know radio, but I won't mention his name here. He introduced me to Ed and said, I think you guys would be friends. You seem very much alike in a lot of ways, and your politics are similar. So Ed and I started talking. He had me on the show as a lawyer. It went well. He invited me on. It became kind of an informal thing. When he needed a lawyer, he invited me on, and he liked the way I presented the law, and after a while, after a couple of years, I started guest hosting for him, and then I launched my show. But I worked in college radio. Back when I was in high school and in college, I worked in college radio, and I loved radio, and I had a third-class FCC license back in the 1970s.
Wow.
I mean, back in those days, you needed a
That's
third-class
right.
FCC
yes,
license
you did.
To touch
yep.
the pots and the carts.
That's right.
We used carts and all of that.
Yep.
So I always loved radio, and it was nice after going off to law school and practicing law for a long, long time. To come back to radio, and now it's all digital. Everything's changed. It's all been consolidated. It's kind of different than it was when I left it in 1981.
Yeah, it is. And in fact, you know, we're about the same age. I think you know, with a few months apart.
I was born in 59.
Me
I
too.
I don't ask people their age.
November of 59. And this year I'm celebrating, believe it or not, my 40th year in radio. I started in college in 1979. I'm one of those weird people that. You know, actually went into the field that I got my degree in. You were smart, though. You went off and got a law degree, so you've got something to fall back on. So you filled in for Ed for a number of years, and then you decided to launch your own show, and you decided to go for it in a big way. You really put together a program, and you spent some money to do it, because it's not, you know, people think, oh, you just turn on the microphone and go, and some people do. You know, there are a lot of different ways to, I was going to say skin that cat, although I hate that saying, so never mind, I didn't say that. There are a lot of different ways to do a radio show, and these days it seems like everybody and their brother thinks, well, I'm kind of funny, I have a computer, I can do a podcast. So there's a lot of competition out there. The problem is, in terms of actual radio, the kind of radio you've been doing for the last 10 years or so on your own show, the kind of radio that I've been doing for the last decade or so or a little more, real progressive talk radio seems to be a dying breed. There are certainly not many stations left, and as far as the stations go, there aren't a whole lot of shows left to populate them.
Well, Nicole, I don't mean to be cute about it, but it really depends on how you define radio.
Yeah.
And really, these days, the word radio, quote-unquote, has changed a lot. And so, I mean, you just referred to a lot of people think it's as simple as getting, you know, some kind of an eye machine and just start putting yourself out on the internet. And there is a lot of clutter. There's my syndicator, our show syndicator, told me at Christmas that there are 500,000 podcasts out there.
Wow.
And 150 of them are making money.
Mm-hmm.
And mine is not one of them, so I know that for sure.
Mine isn't either. Just so you know.
Well, there you go. So, but we have a lot of company, and I suspect that number, he gave me that number at around Christmas time. Mm. And so, you know, here we are a couple of months later. I'm sure the number is now well north of 500,000. So it's a very crowded environment. And I mean, look at it back in the day, 40 years ago, 50 years ago, before all this stuff, there were these gatekeepers, right? Because if you wanted to be a radio star, a TV star, you'd have to, like in the movies, you have to get past the casting couch if you were a woman.
Right.
And, you know, there were these, like, filters. There were people who controlled access. If you wanted to be a big star, you'd have to get through these people that controlled access to the airwaves to be a radio star. And once they let you through, you could be a big TV star, radio star. That's all been obliterated now with the internet and the technology. Everybody can just rush their way right on to the internet, and everybody has. Because just as you said, everybody's got something to say. Everybody thinks they're funny. Everybody thinks they can just instantly command a giant audience because of the brilliance of their elocution, right? And I have the
mm-hmm.
best words.
Yes.
And so we're all drowning in content now, and there's really no way to pick through it. And so for me, I still saw value in AM radio.
Mm-hmm.
And I figured we could create, kind of cobble together a business model by having some AM radio stations, by getting over-the-air advertising and the traditional revenue, and then taking all the ads out and adding an extra segment a day only for premium subscribers, and call that our podcast, and give them the whole show without commercials, hour by hour, and the full show is one file. We give it to them as two different options, and I prepare an extra segment a day just for
wow.
the podcasters, just for the paying customers, that we call Beyond the Norm, and there's hundreds of those, and there's a searchable database. So I was trying to create value for people to spend $10 for a month, and I was hoping that between a combination of podcast revenue from people who could afford $10 a month, and they could take us on the go and download
mm-hmm.
it. You know, it was very flexible. Once you buy it, it's yours, and you could stream it in your car and, you know, do all the time shifting that we do.
Sure.
And hopefully get enough over-the-air ads. And we did really well with advertisers on the small platform we had. But the problem is the industry's consolidated since Bill Clinton signed the Newt Gingrich written, you know,
Telecommunications Act. Yep.
Right?
Yep.
And so that destroyed things because it all got consolidated. Then Air America came along, and Air America was kind of a flop. And they said, see, liberal talk doesn't work. I don't know what liberal talk is. I suspect you don't sit there saying, hi, this is liberal talk, and this
no.
is what you're expected
right.
to hear when you tune mm-hmm. in for liberal talk. No, you're doing the Nicole Sandler show. I'm doing the Norman Goldman show. I don't know what liberal talk is. I know what the Norman Goldman show is. I know what the Randy Rhoads show is. I know what the Stephanie Miller show is. I know what the Tom Hartman show is. In radio, and you know this better than me. You've been in radio your whole life.
Yep.
I went in and out.
Yep.
I mean, the idea is you're supposed to go show by show, whether it's a cooking show, right? A therapist helping couples with their relationship, right? A gardening show.
Well, that's what talk radio
with pets.
That's what
right?
talk
whatever the
right. That's what talk radio used to be. I mean, I tell the story often that when my first big job after college, I moved to New York and I got a job at WMCA, which was a big talk station.
I love WMCA.
Well,
I listened as a kid, The Good Guys.
Yeah, this was when they were talk. This was I was there. I think I went in 1983, maybe,
wow.
Or 1981. Wow. After I graduated from college, 1981 to 83, I was there, and at that time they were. It was just a talk station. It wasn't conservative. It wasn't progressive. It was everything. They had the news block in the morning. They had the radio psychologist. They had the liberal Barry Gray. They had the investment guy. Then they had the, you know, the ultra right wing Bob Grant, who I wound up producing. I mean, they had everything under one roof. And that was a radio station. It was talk radio. It wasn't segregated. You had all different ideas and opinions, and people actually had conversations about issues. And if you covered one issue of importance, the fairness doctrine was still in effect. So we'd put out a call to other people saying, we want to offer you the chance to come on and respond and present the other side of the story, which was mandated by law. That doesn't exist anymore. So everything is different now.
Well, but the one thing that applied, there was a set of rules that applied to all the shows you just described. Mm-hmm. And they were a well-known and very, very followed set of rules, generally followed set of rules. Here goes. Does the host attract a large enough audience? Number one. Does the host attract enough advertisers? Number two. Do the advertisers get enough revenue from the advertising to the large enough audience to justify the show? Does the show, number three, does the show make enough money to pay the host and provide the station a profit? Mm-hmm. There was a series of tests, standardized tests, that you could apply to a car show, right? Two guys rebuilding Camaros in the garage kind of thing. No matter the station, you know, the shows you were talking about, no matter what it was, cooking, gardening, right, therapist show, there was always a standard set of tests.
Yep.
Is the host providing compelling content enough to attract a large audience, attract enough advertisers, and make enough money to make everybody happy? And the last one, of course, is more technical. Does the host protect the license of the radio stations, right? No cussing on the air, no Howard Stern-y kind of edgy stuff that gets everybody at the FCC upset. But as long as you, you know, as a host do that, and I've been asking this radio industry to apply that old school test to my show, to Tom, Stephanie, you, everybody, and just do it the old school way, and they would be very surprised to find that there's a lot of very successful potential shows out there if they would just give us a chance. And Nicole, that's where I got done in, because they decreed me that the podcasting part, I think we did fine. For our relatively modest exposure and distribution, we got a lot of people to sign up for our $10 a month product, but not enough that we needed. And the over-the-air revenue just was never there. We came actually kind of not too far away, but we were denied access to radio stations. They decreed me a failure and never gave me a chance to prove I was a failure. I mean, if you want to decree me a failure, give me a chance to fall flat on my face,
right,
and I'll be the first one to say, you were right, I suck, I can't do a radio show, there is no revenue, there's no ratings, I apologize for telling you I was good, I'll leave now.
Yeah.
I'll be the first one to say that, but at least give me a chance. Don't decree me a failure and then say, we won't give you a chance to prove us wrong.
Right. Well, now, I mean, the numbers of so-called progressive talk stations that are still on the air around the country has dwindled. I don't have the exact numbers, but it's a fraction of what it was, say, in the early days of Air America, when it was at its height, which there weren't that many then either. And what's sad is, you know, Clear Channel started getting rid of them. They got rid of the one in Portland and the one in San Diego, and of course the one here in Miami and
LA
and San Francisco, and then they wound up bringing one back.
San Francisco's back. Yeah.
I know it's back, but yeah, you know, maybe too little, too late, because all the other ones are gone. There's a handful left, and instead of, you know, stations being creative and finding who, you know, great shows to put on the air, not to knock our colleagues, but it's the same old, same old. I'm sorry, you can turn on XM and hear Stephanie Miller and Tom Hartman. But they're also on every, you know, local station, that every local so-called progressive talk station. Then there are people, I can guess what happened with you. I mean, I was doing mornings on WINZ before they flipped to sports. And in fact, when they fired me, I had just had my first book where I beat the first ratings period, where I beat WIOD. That's why they had to take me off the air, because I did better than their flagship station. We were the ugly stepchild. And that's when they replaced me with Imus, as they were waiting for the Fox Sports Network to come available for the contract to run out at another station. But this is the way of the business. That was Clear Channel. Now, you know, iHeartRadio. I was hoping that, you know, after the consolidation phase finished, that there would be sort of a divestiture phase where the big companies would be selling off stations and the mom and pops would come back. Unfortunately, I think it was a little too pie in the sky. I don't think that's going to happen.
I don't see it happening, nor do I see them giving us a chance. I mean, they've kind of choked us off. And,
mm-hmm.
and the problem is that trying to get people to do this kind of talk radio, however you want to characterize it, is going to be impossible, if not next to impossible, because there's no path to profitability. And unless and until a demonstrated business model can be shown, why would people, I mean, I've lost a boatload of money because I decided I was going to do a show the way I wanted to do a show. I was going to get it out on the satellite, mm-hmm. thus making it accessible to a bunch of AM radio stations, right? I was going to have a permanent crew and have a payroll and provide health insurance and make it a full-time gig. I mean, I decided to invest the money to really try and make it a professional, polished, you know, well-produced show. To make it attractive,
right.
as attractive as possible, and we did that. I think it's a winning show.
You did,
show.
Absolutely.
But we have been just,
And you're priced out of the market. And I'm guessing that the stations that pick you up didn't actually pay you a salary, that they shared the revenue with you.
Right, it's all barter. That's the model. Mm-hmm. Is we carve up the commercial minutes of the hour. They get theirs and keep the revenue, and I get mine and keep the revenue. And therein lies the key, because the more stations I have in radio, of course, you know it better than me. They call them markets.
Yep.
Because it's more than one city. The signal travels up beyond city limits, of course. So a radio, you know, the New York market, of course,
right.
is much more than New York City, and it, you know, there's a massive concentration of humanity there. So a big signal like WABC, you know. If this show, if our show, your show, Tom, anybody, if we were on WABC, you know, the advertising rate would be so much larger, and KABC in Los Angeles. So getting access to cities like Miami, Philadelphia, Boston, Houston, on and on, Cleveland, Detroit, Toledo, Fresno, etc., the more stations you have in more markets, you're running exactly the same ads. And I had three advertisers towards the end that I was performing very, very well for on mm-hmm. a limited platform.
Wow.
And I'm telling everybody in the industry, take a look at our numbers here. The advertiser's super happy. And look at our little limited distribution. Put this on a bigger platform. There's no reason to think it won't provide the same results. But apparently nobody wants to make money. Liberal talk doesn't work is the rule, even if there's a demonstrated winner sitting at your doorstep. It's very frustrating.
Right. And again, having been inside a progressive talk station and seeing how, again, it was under Clear Channel, they had the progressive talker and they had the right-wing talker. The right-wing talker got all the resources, all the staff, all the money, all the promotions, and we were the ugly stepchild. For a while there, I was the morning host and producer when I was put in the host seat. They didn't get me my own producer. They also didn't give me a raise. And I remained the promotion director. I mean, it was the only employee at the local station. It seems like our shows have sort of been both ends of the spectrum. When Air America went off the air, so after WINZ, I wound up going to Air America for its last less than a year. When they went off the air, I moved online. And I had been broadcasting from my home down here in Florida to Air America. So the night they went off the air, I just moved online. I was already on, I think, Ustream at the time, and just kept it going. It'll be 10 years on January 21st. It happened to be the day that the Supreme Court handed down the Citizens United decision. Was the day Air America went off the air. It was a double whammy that day. But I've been trying to do my show, you know, on as low a budget as one can. Here, I'm going to play something for you, Norm. This is one of the opens I used to run to kick off the show a couple times a week.
When Nicole Sandler sits down to do her show, she's the producer, booking the guests, pulling the audio, planning the show, the engineer, running the controls, troubleshooting any problems, playing the sounds, calling the guests, and she's the webmaster, writing the blog, posting the podcast, maintaining the website, not to mention the host, interviewing the guests, explaining the issues, giving opinions, and calling out the bad guys. And then you get the Nicole Sandler Show on NicoleSandler.com.
So and so even with that business model where I do everything myself, you know, it's hard to make ends meet. Now, I used a different model. I tried to use the public radio model wherein there's no paywall. People are, you know, on their honor system, if they can afford it, to make a donation, just because I know that so many people are still hurting. There is no right way and no wrong way to do it. What we're finding, though, is when you do it as a standalone, without the backing of a big network or a big company behind you, it's really hard to make ends meet. And Norm, I'm imagining you had a staff, you had a payroll, you paid health insurance. I can't imagine how you got through it. And as you said, it cost you a lot of money. How did you make the decision to stop? I mean, that's honestly something that I struggle with all the time.
Well, for me, it was a question of scale, because with the access to the radio stations that we had because we were on a satellite, we were able to reach a somewhat larger audience, mm-hmm. and we were able to somewhat use the virality of the internet to get more and more people to know who we were. So we were able, you know, in 2015, we almost broke even.
Wow.
And that was pretty good because, you know, we generated a couple hundred thousand dollars. And the problem is we spent more than a couple hundred thousand dollars. And so since 2015, we've been going backwards. We've been losing radio stations and losing podcasters.
Yep.
And so the reason to quit was just like, well, we set aside this amount of money to potentially lose. We went in with our eyes wide open. And, Nicole, I really don't want anyone to think, including you, I don't want anyone to think I'm complaining about it.
Mm-hmm.
We went in. We knew it was a rigged and fixed system. And there's the great irony, right? Benedict Donald's out there was out there in the days before the election saying it's going to be rigged and fixed because he thought he would lose. But the truth is, it is a rigged and fixed system. It's a consolidated, oligarchic radio. You know, these are public airwaves
yep.
that have been privatized.
Yep.
And from Ronald Reagan onward, and so we're being denied access to public airwaves because they've been privatized, and now the value has been destroyed because a bunch of pirate, criminal, corporate crony capitalists yanked all the money out, destroyed 80% of the jobs, destroyed the radio, and so I knew all that. My wife and I have her money. Frances gets the credit, too. She and I knew going in that it was going to be a daunting task. So I'm not shedding any tears. We knew it was a really good chance we'd lose a boatload of money. But we wanted to try it, see if we could make it work, see if we could forge a business model. There really isn't any. I mean, BuzzFeed's laying off.
Yep.
You know, a lot of people.
A lot of digital media.
The digital age is preventing a business model, apparently, from forming. And until one can form, I don't see why people would come into this business.
Right.
There's
well, people.
Got to be a business model.
You know, I've got a chat room going on YouTube and another one at NicoleSandler.com. We're a two-chat room show. And people are asking if you're going to be continuing with a podcast or anything going forward. What's the game plan going forward?
Well, for the immediate term, I'm turning a page. I'll be on social media. I may be somewhat, you know, less active on it, but I have to take some time off.
Mm-hmm.
I want to take some time off. It's been 9.5 years,
wow.
and I very rarely took a vacation. I very rarely take a day off. And with all the financial aggravation of all that, it really has kind of taken a lot out of me. So I'm really tired, frankly. And, you know, if the financial aspect of it were not there, if I wasn't losing $10,000 a month,
ooh.
You know, I might feel a little better about things.
Uh-huh.
But at this point, I really need to just kind of take a break, take a few months off, just putter around for a while. I've got a little bit of a bucket list. So I'm going to step back for a while. I feel like I need to step back for a while. And then who the heck knows what's going to happen. I've already endorsed Elizabeth Warren.
Have you?
Senator Warren be great. Yes,
really?
I have. I think she, look, but I'm not a purity police member.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a captain, a lieutenant, or
yep.
even a beat cop in the progressive purity police. If she doesn't make it, I'm happy with whoever we end up. They're all great. I love them all. They're all going to be terrific. We're going to make America really great again with any of them.
Yeah, any of them would be better than the clown that's in there now, that's for sure. Let me ask you this question, because I know I'm not alone. And I know he wouldn't mind me saying it. Brad Friedman of the Bradcast is a good friend of mine. And he and I have been commiserating, you know, off the air about the fact that we've both been going through a really rough time since Trump's election. I suffer from depression, and I've fallen into deep, bad, depressive, you know, states for dealing with this stuff on a day in and day out basis. Brad, too, has told me he's having a hard time often getting through the day because there's so much shit out there. How are you feeling about the future of our country? I mean, walking away while so much stuff is going on.
Well, I know this is going to sound crazy, but I'm very optimistic about the future.
Wow.
I'm serious. Here's what I see. I see, depends on the word you want to use. Some would call it a backlash. Some would call it a pendulum swinging in the other direction.
Mm-hmm.
I choose to call it true economic populism coming to the fore. This idiot in the White House, what he did was he hijacked the anger of a lot of people towards the fact that those bailouts happened 10 years ago and nobody was held to account, and the, you know, the party was going on and they got bailed out and nobody was held accountable and no taxes were raised. Now there's been more, you know, of the wealth and income inequality. People are really mad, and he saw that, and he knew it, and that's why he used all that fake populism stuff about it's a rigged system, and the rich and the elites are getting away with murder. I mean, he was one of them,
right.
And Obama, President Obama, he saw it, and he was mocking Trump. He's out there saying, you know, now the guy's talking out there like he's a populist.
Norm, we got like 20 seconds left. we got to wrap
all
it up.
Well, anyway, the point is that he screwed the pooch, if you pardon my use of the term.
Yep.
Trump screwed the pooch. He used the nativism of the know-nothing era of the 1850s and the racism of George Wallace from the 1960s, and that's all flaming out. America's not that now.
No.
So America's returning to the prairie populace of Kansas and Nebraska from the 1890s, and we're heading for a nice long populist era with a lot of taxes on the rich and expansion of public services. I see it coming. That's what I see.
Okay. Norman Goldman, people will still find you at on Twitter at Norman Goldman. What'll happen to normangoldman.com?
I'm keeping it. I'll keep stuff up there. There'll be plenty of audio up there. I'll stay in touch on Twitter. I'm keeping Facebook, the Norman Goldman Show on Facebook.
Okay.
I will let people know what I'm doing, where I am. There's plenty of ways to stay in touch. I've got an Instagram account. I'm not disappearing.
Cool.
I will step away, but I'll stay in touch.
All right. And stay in touch with us, too. And if you ever have a burning commentary you need to get out, you always have a place here.
Thank you. You're very kind.
Well, it's my pleasure. Thank you
Good
so
luck.
Much, Norm.
Good luck. It's a daunting, daunting environment out there.
That it is. Thank you so much, Norman Goldman. Great to talk to you. Take care.
Thanks, Nicole.
All right.
Good luck.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Tomorrow, it's Thursday. It's Howie Klein Day, and we're late. So we'll see you tomorrow. Thanks for listening, everyone. Bye-bye.